my friend, the one that I give you, you know, because the one from El Salvador and Central American people, you know, they have the job permit. With that job permit, if they have an emergency in the country, they can ask immigration to give you a permit to go. And they give you the permit to go, but you have to use a lawyer to get that permit. Mean like you have to pay the lawyer. And then you go there, and then when you come back by plane, you get the I-94. And that's the tricky thing now. Then I told her, you know, because when I went to ADP with this lawyer there to give all the information, I say, what she needs is to get the I-94. And I say to her, go to El Salvador. And she say, I am scared to go. She say, I'm going to get stuck there. And I give you the card for the lawyer. I said, talk with this lawyer. He's going to make sure that you come back. And then he went there, you know, with the son that born here. They went together to El Salvador. And then she come back, of course, when he come back 2 weeks after, he had the I-94. And now she already have the appointment to go for the immigration thing for the green card. But what happened? I said, how much you pay? I said, it's $8,000 that I've been spending this paper. How much you pay to immigration now for the green card? It's $1,000 just for the green card, and $600 for the forgiveness letter that she had to send to the government to ask for forgiveness to be illegal in this country. You know, these people—that's a new thing because this hasn't happened before. Now everybody have to go to fix paper to be illegal in this country. They have to have a letter asking for forgiveness to be illegal in this country and pay $600. And every time it's going to be more and more. Look at what happened with the people that have jobs, the immigrants that have permit to go to work. When they started to pay for that permit, it was only $75. 5 or 6 years ago, they was already paying $350 every year for everybody in the family to work. You know, they pay, and then they pay taxes because they pay them by check and they have to pay taxes too. They don't receive any service, no health care, no coupons, no nothing. The only one that receive insurance is the kids, you know, because the kids, no matter if it's a legal kid here, the law in Massachusetts, they have to have insurance. You see, even if it's a legal kid, because it's younger than 20 years old, I think, they have to have insurance, even the dentist insurance. The mass health give you to them, the kid, and not the adult. And now what happened is, you know, there are so many people from El Salvador and maybe the other countries too, that they have more than 20 years here, be working without permit. They already have his own business, his own house, but they are still illegal in this country. Because if the law doesn't change, and they decide don't give you that permit anymore, they will be in the legal situation. And they have to leave the country. And then, you know, it's one over here, I think it's in Northampton or Florence. That one was the Ecuadorian guy. What happened with the people from South America is that they don't have a work permit. They are completely legal in this country. But what they do is they get the ID for pay taxes. That means that because the most of the people from Ecuador is very seem to see, you know, that they have different, like people from El Salvador are in restaurant, people from Ecuador are in construction, electrician, carpenter, masonry, all kind of stuff. But these people get the ID to pay taxes when they work for, because they push his own company. They are very hard worker and very smart people, very, very smart and very honest too. It's sad to see a guy, you know, this guy over here, they have the house already and everything, and was married with the woman from El Salvador. What happens? They deport him. The woman gets stuck with the house. He have to rent part of the house, and on the way to support the house, I don't know if she already sold the house because she was not able to support the house without him. What happened with another one in El Salvador? Here they decide to go because he say, I am tired. Every time that they took me to immigration, I had to pay $500 to the lawyer, and they never fix anything for me. I have to go, he said, and then he left. He's back there. Most of the women from Ecuador that were over there doing cleaning, you know, they driving without license. Because immigrants here are not able to have a license. You can go to Rhode Island and get a license there, or Providence, you know, but not in Massachusetts. They are not able to have a license. And then what they do is driving without a license, ask another people that insurance the car for them. But then, you know, when, like they say, the suspicion was another lady that was cleaning houses in Belchertown, was the first time that go to that house. And of course, you know, she was going around and around to try to find the house. The police saw her that was like a suspicious woman, you know, and stopped her and give you a ticket and tell her to call somebody to come to pick up the car. She never got to do the house anymore because she was scared to go to Belchertown. You know, it's very stressful, the situation that they live. Like every day, they don't know if they're going to come back home. And then the other thing that made me laughing about the law here, you know, in my country, when we have the civil war, United States bring this group, you know, the war for human, what you say, human right or human, you know, when you do something wrong to the people, I think it's human right. Yeah, I think it's something in human right, you know, that we cannot treat nobody in the bad way, you know, because that's wrong in the way that we treat people over there. And then I say, but how come the human rights work in the other countries, but the human rights doesn't work in this country? How come that these children, that they are American citizens, that the father are illegal, yes, but the children is American citizens, that children have the right to have their parents with them? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. This is American citizen, huh? He have the right to have his family with him. What the law over here destroyed these families. They don't know the damage that they are doing to these people because they deport the parents, but they keep the children here. They did to the lady in Springfield. They sent her to Guatemala and they put the children in foster home. You think that this is right? No. And this is inhumanity. Is that one go again to the human right? And that's what I don't get at the law in this country. You know, they kill somebody, they put women in jail because they kill a child that was maybe 2 months or 3 months and they put it in the dump. But they don't put nobody in jail when they kill the children inside the mother. For me, it's the same thing. For me, it's the same thing. We have to respect human beings' life. No matter if they are black, white, or what country or what language they speak. We are one and we are family. No matter where we are. We come to this country to work. The immigrants don't come here to steal money. Don't come here to live free. They come here to work. I have a document that maybe you like to have it, because I know that I cannot speak too much. But it's a document that is happening in the town in Florida. The name is Jupiter. That one was a in the New York Times in February 25, they get this article. I bring some copies that somebody's interested in reading. It's a town in Florida that they have a lot of immigrants from Guatemala. At the beginning, you know, people get some racing against them, but finally it was a group there, like you are doing here in Northampton, to try to help and resolve this situation. Now they are sisters with the town in Guatemala where these people come from. And they have so many programs for the immigrants that they are working together. I think it's something that you can hear in Northampton. Maybe you can read this one and see if something like this you can do here. Of course, over here we don't see the worker in the corner waiting for somebody to pick up to give you a job. But if you go to Boston, you can see that one. That people go to the corner to find somebody to pick it up them to bring for the job for the day. Over here we don't see it, but this one is still happening around here. Thank you very much for your passion.
Hi, I'm Richard Hernandez, Human Rights Commissioner for Northampton. I was listening to one of the panelists say things about how the government encourages city officials and state government to do things. And, you know, I have to admit this because, you know, it's kind of embarrassing. I've never once read our Constitution and entirely the whole thing.
Not most.
I know, most people haven't, but I'll admit it though, You know, but at least that takes a, it takes a minute though, it does. It does. So, as I was reading it, you know, it dawns on me that, you know, the inconsistencies how government is run today, mainly local government, okay? And basically, I had something written before that I was gonna say, but after reading it 2 weekends ago and sitting there really thinking, I just kind of put something together, you know, as to my thoughts on what we are doing here, why we're here, you know? So what I wrote was, Congress often seeks to exercise its power by offering or encouraging the states to implement national programs consistent with national minimum standards as a way to offset their duties and responsibilities. And this lack of accountability uses valuable resources. For instance, they use local law should not be used to fund federal responsibility, and such actions could reduce such actions could result in reduction of local law enforcement resources and thus constitute a cost shift. It requires training, which costs taxpayer money, which mainly comes a lot about money here. It has a negative impact on our communities as it undermines the relationship between local law agencies and the communities they serve. Also to point out, it's probably a very important thing that I read in the Constitution, or, you know, on the side of the Constitution and reading notes here and there and going from website to website, a lot of what's going on is very preemptive to our civil rights. Now, what I mean by that, it's preemptive when the federal system encourages state governments to participate in or enact its federal laws with no clause in the Constitution to authorize it. If the Constitution doesn't authorize it, then by definition of the law, it is illegal, and it opens the door to civil lawsuits based on the preemption clause. I read in the Constitution that the Constitution limits the ability of the federal government to use state government as an instrument of the national government. If that's true, then using local law as an instrument of national government is preemptive to the Constitution, therefore making it a constitutional violation. So, in closing, as a human rights commissioner and a liaison, and in principle, and on my own behalf, I support the AFC, the AFSC, the BRDC, too many kind of bringing us down, and the ACLU of Massachusetts. And once their ordinance reaches its final phase, I'm confident that the commission will, you know, support it as well. Thank you.
So thank you again to all of our panelists. We're gonna take questions now, so if anyone wants to come up, please feel free.
Not everybody at once.
Don't run.
Thank you all for bringing us out here. My question is to the ordinance and the effect of this ordinance. My name is Elliot Terry, by the way. And I believe that we dance around the word fascism. Judge Michael Ryan was arrested in the parking lot here in Northampton. During his trial, he